students, today we are going to start second lesson of class 6th history, that is on the trail of the earliest people. So in this lesson we are going to study the terms like the earliest people and the various skills or the knowledge these people require for hunting and gathering, the various reasons why hunter gatherers moved from place to place. Then we will see how do we know about these people and the stone tools which they made, for what purpose they used those stone tools. Then some important terms like sites, factory sites, and habitation from factory sites. Then we will see two different techniques which were used by hunter gatherers for making stone tools. Let's start with the first point, the earliest people. Now here we are talking about the Paleolithic period. Last year you have already studied about the Paleolithic age or Paleolithic period, Mesolithic period and Neolithic period. Now Paleolithic period means that the old stone age in which mostly the stone tools were used by the hunter gatherers. Now the time which we are talking here, almost 2 million years ago, the group of people who lived in the subcontinent were called hunter-gatherers. In last chapter, I have already explained who were called hunter-gatherers, so what was their source to obtain the food. But once again we will see, these hunter-gatherers hunted wild animals, gathered fruits, roots, nuts, seeds, leaves, etc. They also caught fish and birds. For these things, they required certain skills or knowledge. It means that hunting and gathering was not easy task for these people. Now let's see which were the skills these people required for hunting and gathering. Alertness, quickness, presence of mind. It means that for hunting animals or for catching fish and bird, these people need to be very alert, quick in their action and have lots of presence of mind. Because there were several animals which were stronger and bigger than them, and as well as they ran faster than these people. So to hunt those animals, these people need to be very alert and very quick in their action. If they would be careless, then instead of hunting the animals would hunt them. Again, for gathering also, for gathering the forest produce, they need to find out which plants or its parts are edible. Because we know that all the plants and all the parts of the plants cannot be edible. So there were several plants which could be poisonous. So it means that they need to differentiate, or they should have the knowledge to differentiate among the edible and non-edible plants. So we already discussed about it, that in Paleolithic period that there were no permanent settlements, the people were nomads, so they had to move from one place to another place. Now here are some reasons have been given why hunter-gatherers moved from place to place. Now let's see first one, resources will be exhausted at one place. It means that if these hunter-gatherers had stayed on one place for long time, then what would happen? They would have eaten up all the plants and animal resources which were available in their surrounding. So to avoid this, what they did? They did not stay on one place for long time. After some time that they had moved to other places where they would find plenty of animal and plant resources for their food. That was the first reason. Second reason was hunters moved with animals. Now the animals whom these hunters hunted, those animals also depend on others. For example, that these animals, they also move in search of their prey or sometimes some animals they moved in search of grass or leaves. So if these hunters wanted to hunt them, then they had to follow the movements of these animals. So this was the second reason of the movements of hunter gatherers. Third reason was plants are seasonal, so gatherers move. Again, as we know that all the plants and all the trees do not bear fruit in every season. Different plants or different trees get the fruit in different seasons. So if these gatherers wanted to collect the different kinds or variety of fruits, or if they wanted to eat different kinds of fruit, then what was needed for them? They need to move to various places according to the season. And that was also one of the reason for their movement. Next reason was water sources. Some were perennial and others seasonal. As we know that water is one of the basic necessity of the living thing. Without water, living things cannot survive. So here, what is important, but some rivers are perennial and some rivers are seasonal. So what is meant by perennial rivers and lakes? The rivers and lakes which have the water throughout the year, they are called as perennial rivers. And seasonal rivers means the rivers which have the water only in a particular season, that is rainy season. Now, the people, those who were living on the banks of these perennial rivers, they didn't have to go anywhere else in search of water, because water was available throughout the year in these perennial rivers. But the people, those who were living on the banks of these seasonal rivers, so after the end of the rainy season or in dry season, they had to go to another place in search of water. For example, winter and summer season. So this was also one of the basic reason for the movements of the hunter gatherers. Next was, sometimes these hunter gatherers also moved or traveled to meet their friends and relatives. So these are some of the basic reasons. So why hunter gatherers move from place to place. Now our next point is, how do we know about these people? We can come to know about them with the help of archaeologists. But students, how archaeologists come to know about them? Archaeologists found some of the things which were made and used by these hunter gatherers and left behind on various places or sites where they lived. Now what archaeologists used to do? Archaeologists used to search those places, they excavate them and find out the things that were used by hunter gatherers. And with the help of those things, they try to tell us or explain us about the life of hunter gatherers, means what kind of life these hunter gatherers had. Now the various tools that these people used, they were made up of stone, bone, wood. But out of them, stone tools were proved best to survive. Now, next point is some uses of stone tools. Means the stone tools which were made by these people, those were used for various purposes. Now, let's see one by one for what purpose these stone tools were used. First one, to cut meat and bone. To cut the meat and bone, they use the stone tools. To scrap bark and hides. Now what is meant by hides? Hides means the skin of the animal. So how, what they used to do? They used to separate the skin from its flesh. And for that purpose, they use these stone tools. To chop fruits and roots. To chop wood. And wood was used as for fire, then for making huts and for making tools. To dig ground. So they use these stone tools to dig the ground in order to find out the edible roots. To stitch cloths from animal skin. They also used these stone tools as a needle so that they could stitch the clothes with the animal skin. To make spear and arrow. So what they, how they made the spear and arrow? They used to attach the stone tools to the handles of bone and wood. to make the spear and arrow. And these spear and arrows were used for hunting. Now, next point is, here we are going to learn some important terms. First one is sites, then factory sites, habitation cum factory sites. Listen students, these three terms are very, very important. First one is sites. Now, what is meant by site? Sites are the places where the remains of things like tools, buildings, etc. were found. It means that the things that were used in the past, or which were available in the places. So, those places are called as sites. Now, these things, they may be located or situated on the surface of the earth. They may be buried under the surface of the earth, or they may be found under the water. Now, many sites were located near sources of water. It means that I already told you water is one of the basic necessity. So, wherever the water was easily available, there only that these hunter-gatherers lived. People preferred to leave the places where good quality stone was available. As I told you, here we are talking about old stone age. It means that, and during which that only, means mostly the stone tools were used on large scale. So, wherever the good quality stone was available, there only that these hunter-gatherers lived. Okay, or they made the, or they stayed over there. Now, the next term is factory sites. Now, what is meant by factory sites? I already told you, for making the stone tools, good quality stone was required. So, wherever the good quality stone was available and people made the stone tools, those places are called as factory sites. Means factory sites are the places where the good quality stone was easily available and where the people made the stone tools with the help of that good quality stone. Now, what were found at these factories? Means what the archaeologists found over there? Archaeologists have found block of stones, means the big block of stone which were used for making the stone tools. Then the chips of waste stone. It might be possible that while making the stone tools, that whatever the chips or the flakes that were removed, so those chips have found on these factory sites. Then stone tools, that the stone tools which were discarded by these people, discarded means what? Means which were not in proper shape, that's the reason they had thrown them. So such type of stone tools were also have also found by the archaeologists in these factory sites. Now the next point is habitation cum factory site. Now habitation cum factory sites are the places where people live for longer spell of time. Now these are the places where people live for long time, and as well as here they made the stone tools. Now to live, as they had lived over there for long time, they need some shelter to stay, and for that they used caves and rock shelters so that they could protect themselves from rain, heat and wind. So next point is making stone tools. The two different techniques were used by hunter-gatherers for making the stone tools. First technique is stone on stone. Now here core means the stone from which that the tool was to be obtained. So that was held in one hand, and in other hand another stone called hammer that was held. Now the second stone or the hammer, it was used to strike on the core to remove the flecks from the core stone. And this was, or in another word we can say that hammer was hit on the core so that the flakes could be removed, and this was continued till the required shape is obtained from this core. So this is what stone on stone method. Now the second technique was pressure flaking technique. Now here what was done? So core was placed. Core means, again I'll tell you here, that core is the stone from which that the stone tool was to be obtained. So this ore or the main stone that was placed on the firm surface or on the ground, and over that the piece of bone or stone that was placed, and then hammer was used to strike on this piece of bone or stone to remove the flakes from the core. And continuously this process was going on till the core gets its proper shape. So this is what the pressure flaking method, and with the help of these two methods that the hunter gatherers made the stone tools. And remaining part of the lesson that we will see in the next video. Hello students, let's continue with the second lesson on the trail of the earliest people. In the previous video we have seen about, or we studied about, the earliest people and the various reasons for which they moved from place to place, and the various tools they made and used, and the two important techniques for which were used by these hunter gatherers for making the stone tools. These are the things that we have studied in the previous video. Now let's continue this lesson with the point of changing environment. Now here, after all, as the time passes, that there were some major changes in the world. So what kind of changes were there? Around 12,000 years ago, that climate of the, there were major changes in the climate of the world, and that shifted to warmer condition. It means that it might be possible that before this period that the climate of the world might be cool, and after this period that it shifted towards the warm condition. It means that the environment or the climate became warmer, and due to this reason, or due to this, what happened? This led to the development of grasslands in various parts of the world. So grasslands were developed in different parts of the world, and as these grasslands developed, then grass eating animals were also increased, like deer, sheep, goat, cattle, antelope, etc. So these animals were also increased. Now these hunter gatherers, they followed these animals to hunt them. Means wherever these animals used to move to eat the grass, these hunter gatherers also followed them to hunt them. And as a result, what happened? These hunter gatherers or these people, they learned about their food habits, means what kind of food that these animals eat, as well as about their breeding season, means when they give the birth to their young ones. So these things they learned, and as well as they observed that these animals were gentle in nature as compared to wild animals. Then they thought that they could also keep these animals with them, and in this way that herding and rearing practices were emerged or developed in the subcontinent. And as well as, along with this herding and rearing, fishing was also developed during this period. Now the next is that as the grasslands developed, so some grain bearing grasses grew naturally over there. Now which were those grain bearing grasses? Like wheat, barley, then rice. Now these people, means these hunter gatherers, they observed these plants carefully, and they noticed that how they grew, or when the seeds ripen. So they observed these things carefully, and they learned that how they grow, or when they grow, and when the seeds ripen. They learned about these all the things, and they started growing some grains or some plants by themselves. As well as some of the people, means some women, men and children, they also collected these grains so that they could use them as their food. Now this, in this way that the agriculture, herding, rearing, fishing and agriculture was developed in the subcontinent.
Done.
So now our next point is rock paintings and what they tell us. Now here we are going to see, so which are the places where these rock paintings are found and what they tell us. Now as we know that these hunter gatherers, so during the, whenever they wanted to stay on any place for long time, they preferred to live in caves. I already told you. So whenever they were leaving in the caves, so most means some of the hunter gatherers, what they did, they painted that paintings on the walls of those caves. Now there are some examples of cave painting. In Madhya Pradesh, there is one famous place where the cave paintings have found by archaeologists, that is Bhimbetka. Bhimbetka is the place which is famous for cave painting. It is located in Madhya Pradesh. Then there are number of cave paintings or sites that are located in southern Uttar Pradesh. Then what they drawn on these walls or in these paintings? Wild animals. And they draw these wild animals with great accuracy and with great skill. Now our next point is, who did what? Means who did actually what kind of work? Now we have already learned about this. What did early people do? Means what kind of work they did? We have already studied that these hunter gatherers, they hunted wild animals, they gathered fruits, roots, nuts, means forest produce. We also learned that they also made stone tools. Then they painted walls on the of the caves. Their later period, they also started herding, then rearing, then they also started growing plants. These things means these are the various that things that they did in their life. But out of them, can we tell that these particular things were done by the men and these particular things were done by the women? No, we cannot tell this accurately or properly or clearly, because there are no evidences available which can give us information about which things were done by whom. Now here, historians, they have given two possibilities for this. Now they tell us that some of the things that were done only by men and some of the things that were done only by women. And there might be one more possibility that some of the activities they did together, means both of them with each other's help, that they did those activities. So these are the two possibilities that the historians gave about this their work. But there are no evidence which can tell us about clearly that either these things were done by the men and these things were done by the women. Now our next point is names and dates. But before we start this point, students, you should know, or you must know, that the difference between prehistory and history. Prehistory and history. So these two terms are very, very important to know for you. Now, what is meant by prehistory? The part of a history, or the part about which we do not have any written records, that is called as prehistory, and the part about which we have written records is called history. It means that the time about which we do not have any written records, that comes under prehistory, and the time about which we have written record, that comes under the history. Now in this lesson, we have studied about the prehistory. Now, archaeologists have given lengthy names for describing this prehistory. Now, let's see which names that the archaeologists used. And what they did? They divided this prehistory in three periods. That is Paleolithic period, Mesolithic period, and Neolithic period. Now, the earliest period of this prehistory is also called as Paleolithic period. Now this Paleolithic, this word is derived from two Greek words, paleo and lithos. Paleo means old and lithos means stone. It means that Paleolithic period is also called as Old Stone Age. Now this Old Stone Age, it extends from 2 million years ago to about 12,000 years ago. It means that this long stretch of time, that of prehistory or the Paleolithic period, that again divided into three parts: Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic, and Upper Paleolithic period. And we can also say that पैलियोलिथिक पीरियड कवर्स द 99% ऑफ ह्यूमन हिस्ट्री. सो दिस पीरियड इज वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट पीरियड इन प्री हिस्ट्री. नाउ द सेकेंड टाइप इज और सेकेंड पीरियड इज मेसोलिथिक पीरियड. दिस मेसोलिथिक पीरियड इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज मिडिल स्टोन एज एंड इट एक्सटेंड्स फ्रॉम अबाउट 12,000 years ago to about 10,000 years ago. Now, during this Mesolithic period, the stone tools which were used by hunter-gatherers that were very small in size and also in proper shape. So, tiny stone tools were used by the hunter-gatherers. And these tiny stone tools were called as microliths. So, what is meant by microlith? Microliths are the tiny stone tools. This concept is very very important. Then next, these microliths, they attached these microliths or these tiny stone tools with the handles of bone and wood to make the saws and sickles. Now the third period is Neolithic period. Neolithic period is also called as New Stone Age. Now this period starts from 10,000 years ago, which we are going to study in third chapter. Now our next point is, so these are the three important periods that we have studied about the prehistory. You have already studied about this in detail in 5th standard. Here I have given only a short introduction. Now the next point is a closer look at Kunsgi. Kunsgi is one of the important Paleolithic site because here archaeologists have found a number of sites or Paleolithic sites where the people or the ancient people, they made the stone tools. And archaeologists also suggest that this is also one of the habitation come factory site. Because here not only the stone tools were made, but the people stayed or lived for longer period. And here number of Paleolithic sites were found, large number of stone tools or the tools were made by the people. And to make the stone tools, limestone was used. Because the limestone was locally available, it was easily available over there. So that's the reason these people have used the limestone for this. Students, all the points, learn it and read it carefully and prepare for the exam.